So dear devotees, here is our screen and we are discussing Chaitanya Bhagavat Adi Leela, first chapter, verse number 9 onwards. So there is no purport in verse number 9, but there is a purport by Srila Bhakti Siddhant Saraswati Thakur in verse 10. That purport is originally in the Bengali language and it has been translated into English, so we will see that. And on verse 9 and 10, then I will try to speak something. So this is Chaitanya Bhagavat of Sri Vrindavan Das Thakur Adi Leela 1.9. Madbhakta puja bhyadhika sarvabhute shumanmatihi. So, here is the translation. The worship of my devotees should be executed to a greater degree than my own worship. And in all living entities, one should perceive me. So, this is a statement by Bhagavan Shri Krishna himself. And he is saying, Mad Bhakta Puja Abhi Adhika, that Madbhakta puja, that the worship of my devotee is abhi adhika, which means mat puja topi adhika, which means is greater even than my own worship. And that is why it should be carried out. The worship of my devotees should be executed to a greater degree than my own worship. And sarvabhuteshu manmatihi. And sarvabhuteshu, in all living entities, manmatihi, one should see me, one should think of me in all living entities. So the only portion which is mainly which Sri Vrindavan Das Thakur wants to say is Mad Bhakta Puja Abhyadhika. So that's the section which he wants to say. Previously, in Chaitanya Bhagavat itself, he was in verse 8 itself, he had said that Amar Bhaktera Puja Ama Haite Bada, that the worship of my devotees is greater than my own worship. So that he had said in Bangla, Sei Prabhu Vede Bhagavate Kaila Dada. So that Prabhu has said, Bhagavan Krishna has said in Srimad Bhagavatam. But where has he said in Bhagavatam? This is pointed out here. So the relevant portion of the verse is Mad Bhakta Puja Abhyadhika. So this is what is dear to Sri Vrindavan Das Thakur. Why? Because he wants to glorify the devotees. And there is a purpose in glorifying the devotees because he wants his work, Sri Chaitanya Bhagavat, to attain all success. And to attain all success, it is important to attain the mercy of the Lord. But before attaining the mercy of the Lord, one should also attain the mercy of the devotees, because you know the mercy and the worship of the devotees is considered to be greater than the mercy and the worship of the Lord. In Chaitanya Bhagavat, the next verse, Adi, first chapter, verse 10, Sri Vrindavan Das Thakur says, Ete ke karilum age bhaktera vandana ata eva ache karya siddhira lakshana. Ete ke, in this way, karilu age, I have glorified in the beginning, bhaktera vandana, I glorified the devotees. And ata eva, and therefore such glorification, ache karya siddhira lakshana, it is lakshana, it is the characteristic of karya siddhi, success in the endeavor. So I have glorified the devotees, he is saying, and such glorification is the characteristic of success in the endeavor which he has undertaken. So whatever glorification he does, is certainly it will lead to success. In the purport, Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur is quoting many verses related to the worship and glorification of devotees. So in the purport, Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur says, in the Adi Puran, it is stated, Ye me bhakta janah partha, na me bhaktas chate janah, mad bhaktaram chaye bhaktas, te me bhakta tamah mata. Ye me bhakta janah partha. My dear partha, those who claim to be my devotees, na me bhaktas chate janah, are not my devotees. Mad bhaktanam chaye bhaktas, but those who claim to be devotees of my devotees, te me bhakta tamah mata, they are actually my topmost devotees. So here there should be tamah, topmost devotees. Also in the Srimad Bhagavatam 3.17.2, it is said, Durapa yalpa tapasah seva vaikuntha vartmasu yatropagiyate nityam deva devo janardanah. Durapa hi alpa tapasah. Persons whose austerity is meager can hardly obtain what? Seva vaikuntha vartmasu, the service of the pure devotees who are progressing on the path back to the kingdom of Godhead, the Vaikunthas. What happens in the Vaikuntha planets? Yatropagiyate nityam devadevo janardanah. Pure devotees engage 100% in glorifying the Supreme Lord, who is the Lord of the demigods and the controller of all living entities. So this is in Srimad Bhagavatam 3.17.2. In the Padma Puran Uttarkhand, it is stated, Archayitva tu Govindam, tadiyan archayetu yaha, nasabhagavato gyeyaha, kevalam damhikah smritaha. Tasmat sarva prayatnena, vaishnavan pujayet sada, sarvam tarati dukkhaugham, mahabhagavatarchanat. Archayitva tu Govindam, one who performs worship of Lord Govinda. But tadiyanna archayetu yaha, but fails to worship his devotees. Nasa bhagavato gyeyaha, should be understood to be not a devotee of the Lord. So what is he? Kevalam dambhikah smritaha, but simply a victim of false pride. Tasmad, therefore, sarva prayatnena, by all means, Vaishnavan pujayet sada. One should always worship the Vaishnavas by all means. What happens? Sarvam tarati dukkhaugham mahabhagavatarchanat. For by worshipping the Mahabhagavats, the great devotees, sarvam tarati dukkhaugham, one is freed from all multitudes of miseries. So this is a verse which has been quoted from the Padma Puran. Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur says, in this way, various other statements glorifying the worship of pure devotees are found in the scriptures. Now, Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur says, the word Karya Siddhi. So, this term Karya Siddhi was in the original verse of Srila Vrindavan Das Thakur. We can say here, Karya Siddhi Ralakshan, success in the endeavor. So, Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur says, the word Karya Siddhi is explained by Sri Baldev Vidyabhushan in his Govinda Bhashya commentary on Vedanta Sutra 3351, wherein he quotes from the Shandilya Smriti as follows. So what is success in a devotional endeavor? So that is being quoted from the Shandilya Smriti. Siddhir bhavati vaneti samshayochyuta sevinam nishamshayastu tadbhakta paricharyaratatmanam. Then next, kevalam bhagavatpada sevaya vimalam manah najayate yathanityam tadbhakta charanarchanat. Siddhir bhavati va na iti samshayo achyuta sevinam. So one may doubt, samshaya, whether the servants of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Achyuta Sevinam, Siddhir Bhavati Vaneti, will attain perfection or not. But Nishamshayas, but there's absolutely no doubt. तद भक्त परिचर्यार्थात्मना. सो देर इज नो डाउट दैट दोज हु आर अटैच्ड टू सर्विंग हिज डिवोटीज विल अटेन परफेक्शन. सो देर मे बी अ डाउट इफ द डिरेक्ट डिवोटीज ऑफ द लॉर्ड मे अटेन परफेक्शन, बट देर इज एब्सोल्यूटली नो डाउट दैट द डिवोटीज ऑफ द लॉर्ड विल डेफिनेटली अटेन परफेक्शन. केवलं भगवत पाद सेवया विमलं मनः. सो वंस माइंड न जायते, वंस माइंड इज नॉट एज फुल्ली प्यूरिफाइड सिंपली बाय सर्विंग द लोटस फीट ऑफ द सुप्रीम लॉर्ड एज इट इज बाय नित्यम तद भक्त चरणार्चना एज इट इज बाय सर्विंग द फीट ऑफ हिज डिवोटीज. सो ग्रेटर डिग्री ऑफ प्यूरिफिकेशन इज अटेंड बाय सर्विंग द लोटस फीट ऑफ द डिवोटीज. दिस इज मेंशनड हियर एंड श्री भक्तिसिद्धांत सरस्वती ठाकुर देन एंड्स हिज परपोर्ट विद अ फाइनल पैराग्राफ. ही सेज श्रील कृष्णदास कविराज गोस्वामी हैज रिटन इन द चैतन्य चरितामृत आदि लीला 1.20-21 एज फॉलोज. इन द बिगिनिंग ऑफ दिस नरेशन सिंपली बाय रिमेंबरिंग द स्पिरिचुअल मास्टर द डिवोटीज ऑफ द लॉर्ड एंड द पर्सनैलिटी ऑफ गॉड हेड आई हैव इनवोक्ड देयर बेनेडिक्शंस. Such remembrance destroys all difficulties and very easily enables one to fulfill his own desire. So he has also written the same thing. So he is remembering the guru, the devotees, and the personality of Godhead. And Sri Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami has invoked their mercy and benedictions. And such remembrance destroys all difficulties. Difficulties in the path of completing the task, karya siddhi, and very easily enables one to fulfill his desires to achieve siddhi in his karya. So this is the purport by Srila Bhakti Siddhant Saraswati Thakur, and this is where, dear devotees, we are going to pause reading the text and the purport. So in this entire section, Sri Vrindavan Das Thakur is glorifying the devotees. So he is glorifying the devotees for what purpose? So he is glorifying the devotees because he wants to attain karya siddhi. His karya siddhi is that he should be successful in writing the charitra or the characteristics of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So in order to attain karya siddhi, success in his endeavor, so he is composing verses of glorification for the devotees. Now, after knowing this, what is my duty as a speaker? So my duty as a speaker is that I should also try to follow in the footsteps of Sri Vrindavan Das Thakur. And I also want to achieve karya siddhi. I also want to achieve success in this endeavor of speaking that I have undertaken. Therefore, it is important that I should also glorify the devotees. Now, Sri Vrindavan Das Thakur has glorified the other devotees of Chaitanya Leela, but he did not glorify himself. So now is a chance to glorify Sri Vrindavan Das Thakur. So here is a verse which I have tried to compose, which is for the glorification of Sri Vrindavan Das Thakur and praying to him. श्री वृंदावन दासाख्य चैतन्य चरितानुगह श्रीमद् वृंदावनेस्मभ्यं विदधातु रतिं सदा. श्री वृंदावन दासाख्य द डिवोटी नेम्ड श्री वृंदावन दास ठाकुर इज चैतन्य चरित अनुगह is a devoted follower of Chaitanya Charita, of the character of Sri Chaitanya. Srimad Vrindavane, when it comes to Sri Vrindavan Dham, in context of Sri Vrindavan Dham, Asmabhyam Vidadhatu Ratim Sada, may he bestow deep attraction for all of us towards Sri Vrindavan Dham. Srimad Vrindavane Asmabhyam Vidadhatu Ratim Sada, may he always bestow immense rati, deep attraction towards Sri Vrindavan Dham for all of us. So with this prayer to the lotus feet of Sri Vrindavan Das Thakur, I am beginning my explanation of these verses. So what he did, I also tried to do, although my compositions are not as good as his compositions, because he has composed the entire Chaitanya Bhagavat, so many verses, but I am simply able to compose a single verse. So anyways, but in my limited capabilities, I have tried to follow the instruction that he has given, that one should glorify the devotees in order to attain karya siddhi or perfection in one's endeavor. Now, having said this, a doubt may arise that, you know, we have heard that bhakti means devotion towards Bhagavan. In the Padyavali, there is a very simple definition of bhakti given. Very simple. What is the definition of bhakti given in the Padyavali? Bhakti hi seva bhagavato. That bhakti is nothing but seva of Bhagavan. So this very simple definition is given in the Padyavali. Bhakti hi seva bhagavato. So bhakti is service of Bhagavan. So if bhakti is service of Bhagavan, then why is service of devotees being glorified so much here? What is the reason that service of devotees is being glorified so much? All of us must have heard of a literature named Hari Bhakti Vilas. So Hari Bhakti Vilas, you know, so the various manifestations of bhakti of Hari. So that is Hari Bhakti Vilas. But we have not heard of Hari Bhakta Bhakti Vilas. We have not heard of any similar book for Hari's Bhaktas. Similarly, there is Hari Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu. That is our Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu. Whose Bhakti? Hari Bhakti. We have not heard of Hari Bhakta Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu. So, we have to understand one thing, that, you know, if so much emphasis is being given on service of devotees, there has to be some place in Shastra where the service of devotees is especially mentioned as bhakti. Because unless service of devotees is also mentioned as bhakti, then what are we carrying out when we are serving devotees? So, I would like to ask a question to any one devotee who would like to volunteer. Would anybody like to volunteer? I want to ask a question. Any devotee who would like to volunteer at this point of time, I want to ask one question to you. Please, any one devotee.
What's the question?
Yes. So, thank you, Kirtida Sundari Mataji. I would like to ask that if, you know, serving Krishna is bhakti, then what is serving Guru and serving Vaishnavas?
That is also bhakti.
But where is it mentioned in Shastra?
In Chaitanya Charitamrita, as far as I remember, there was a verse that it says that tadya, where that means that anything in relation to Krishna should also be worshipped. And as Rupa Goswami also says, anya bilashita shunim jnana karmani anavritam anukulena Krishna anushilanam bhakti rutama. Anything related to Krishna or Krishna himself is included in the verse of bhakti.
So, yeah, many answers, and in the comments also. So, yes, the verse you have quoted is correct. Anya bhilashita shunyam jnana karmadi anavritam anukulyena Krishna anushilanam. But the verse, Mataji, the verse itself says Krishna anushilanam. So, Krishna's repeated service, and that is bhakti. And there are many other devotees quoting verses and saying, you know, yasya prasadat bhagavat prasado, or there's some devotees saying aradhananam sarvesham. But those are not definitions of bhakti. The definition of bhakti is what Kirtida Sundari Mataji has quoted. I want to know where it is in Shastra that the seva of a devotee is also known as bhakti, where I can confidently say that if I am serving a devotee, then it falls under the technical definition of bhakti. So the verse you have quoted, Mataji, is correct. But where is it mentioned in the verse that service of the devotees is also bhakti?
Krishna Anushilanam.
Right. So Krishna's Anushilanam.
Yeah. So something that pleases Krishna. And when we serve Guru,
right,
it pleases.
Okay. So
it pleases Krishna. So it is favorable to Krishna.
Okay. This is nice. We are going in the correct direction. Actually, by quoting the verse, you have shown us the correct direction, and I'm very thankful to you for that. So this verse, Anyabhilashita Shunyam Jnana Karmadi Anavritam Anukulyena Krishnanu Shilanam Bhaktiruttama. This is the verse which defines bhakti, and it defines the scope of bhakti. And then somebody may say Krishna Anushilanam means service only of Krishna. Then what about cleaning the temple? And what about, you know, sweeping the road of the temple? So these are not mentioned directly, it seems. So in the commentary to that verse, Anyabhilashita Shunyam, the answer is given. So what answer is given, I would like to share with all of you. So Srila Jiva Goswami there says, see, Krishna Anushilanam, if you take the direct meaning, it means Krishna plus Anushilanam, which means Anu, repeated, Shilanam, service towards Krishna. Srila Jiva Goswami says, Tad evam sati, now we know this thing, that the term is Krishna Anushilanam. He says, Krishna Sambandhi Krishnartham va Anushilanam Krishna Anushilanam. He gives two definitions of Krishna Anushilanam. And this is where he clarifies that Krishna Anushilanam means two things. So Srila Jiva Goswami says, Krishna Artham Anushilanam is also Krishna Anushilanam. So what is Krishna Artham? Krishna Artham, in Hindi we will say Krishna ke liye, or in English we will say directly for Krishna. So directly for Krishna. So service directly for Krishna's benefit is Krishna Artham Anushilanam, and that shortens to become Krishna Anushilanam. And second is Krishna Sambandhi Anushilanam. Service to any entity related to Krishna. So that is Krishna Sambandhi Anushil. Now, Jiva Goswami specifically did not restrict it only to people. Sambandhi, any entity, it may be a temple, you know, it may be a shoe stand, it may be anything. Service to any entity which is related directly to Krishna. So that is Krishna Sambandhi Anushilanam. So that also shortens to Krishna Anushilanam. So in this way, Anukulyena Krishna Anushilanam. So Krishna Anushilanam means Krishna Artham Anushilanam, service directly to Krishna. And Krishna Sambandhi Anushilanam, service to any entity which is related, Sambandhi, which is related to Krishna. So in this way, now Kirtida Sundari Mataji, is service of devotees now fully included in the service of Krishna and in the definition of bhakti? Please tell me.
Yes, Prabhuji.
Yes. So this is our praman. When we say that the verse which is quoted is perfect, and this is the, you know, final confirmation from Srila Jiva Goswami that Krishna Anushilanam, the term Krishna Anushilanam, should not be restricted only to direct service of Krishna, Krishna Artham Anushilanam, but it should also be Krishna Sambandhi Anushilanam. So having seen this, dear devotees, we understand now that when we are executing service of Krishna's devotees, when we are executing service of Krishna's temple, when we are executing service of anything which is related to Krishna, then we are executing Krishna Bhakti, or we are executing Bhakti. We can confidently say that. So, is serving a Vaishnav Guru also Bhakti? Answer is yes. Is cleaning the temple also Bhakti? Answer is yes. But on what strength? On the strength of the term Krishnanushilanam. On the strength of interpreting Krishnanushilanam as Krishna Sambandhi Anushilanam. That is why this definition of Srila Rupa Goswami is a 360-degree definition which covers all the aspects of Uttama Bhakti, and no aspect is left out. Otherwise, people will say, well, Krishna Anushilanam only means directly service of Krishna, but not service of Krishna's devotees. So that is not the case. Now, having seen this, another doubt arises. Now, there is another doubt, and I would like to ask that doubt. So, Kirtida Sundari Mataji, I would like to ask another question, that for Krishna, we have defined Navadha Bhakti, nine types of Bhakti. Shravanam, Kirtanam, Vishnu, Smaranam, Padasevanam, Archanam, Vandanam, Dasyam, Sakhyam, Atmanivedanam. But how many types of Bhakti have been described for the devotees of Krishna? Is there any Navadha Bhakti for devotees of Krishna? And how many limbs of Bhakti can we engage in towards devotees of Krishna? So, please give me some answer so that, you know, we can continue the discussion ahead.
I think so, Prabhu. All these nine Navadha Bhakti can be applied even to the devotees also.
Okay.
Like, Ravanam means discussing the pastimes of the devotees, or Kirtanam is glorifying the devotees,
right.
Remembering devotees, offering prayers to devotees,
right.
Circumambulating devotees as Padasevanam.
Right. So, and in the Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu Mataji, there are 64 limbs. So, how many of them are applicable to the devotees?
Practically all of them.
So, the answer which you have given is very correct. Practically, you added the term practically all of them, and which is a very correct answer. Now, this answer has been given by you, and it is very nice. And we have to find a confirmation for it in Srila Rupa Goswami's own writing. So, Srila Rupa Goswami is not going to leave anything out in the Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu. So this question will arise, because earlier he said Krishnanushilanam also means, you know, Rupa Goswami only wrote Krishnanushilanam, but he told Srila Jiva Goswami that Krishnanushilanam has two meanings, Krishna Artham and Krishna Sambandhi, means service also to those devotees who are related to Krishna. Then Srila Jiva Goswami naturally asked him, how many limbs of bhakti can we engaged, you know, we engage in with the devotees of Krishna. So, Srila Rupa Goswami specifically composed a verse. After describing the 64 limbs of bhakti, Srila Rupa Goswami composed a verse. This verse is our pramana in determining how many types of services we can engage in with devotees of Krishna. So, Srila Rupa Goswami says in Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, Eastern Division, Second Wave, verse number 219. Yavanti bhagavad bhakte rangani kathitaniha. Prayastavanti tadbhakta bhakte rapibudha viduhu. So, yavanti, as many bhagavad bhakte rangani, as many limbs of bhagavad bhakti, as many limbs of Krishna bhakti, kathitani iha, are spoken here, described here. Praya, practically, almost all of them, tavanti, tadbhakta bhakte rapi, are applicable to the bhakti of his bhaktas also. Buddha viduhu, intelligent people understand this. So, Srila Rupa Goswami has said, I am reading the translation, the various limbs of bhakti that are described here in Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, in relation to bhakti of Bhagavan, should almost all be understood by the learned to be applicable also to the bhakti of Bhagavan's devotees. So, now question arises, why has he used the term prayah? can we try to, I mean, prayah means almost, you know, almost all of them. So why did he not say, you know, completely all of them, 100%? Why did he say almost prayah in this verse? So prayah he has said because there have to be certain limbs which may not be applicable to the devotees, but which are applicable exclusively to Bhagavan. So, can we try to give an example of one such limb? You know, is there any example of any such limb? Can we try to think of it? Maybe Kirtida Sundari Mataji or anybody else who would like to think of one such limb which is applicable to Krishna exclusively, but may not be applicable to the devotees. So, Kirtida Sundari Mataji. Yes.
Yeah, I think of like in one of the 64 limbs of bhakti, it is mentioned that you have to pay obeisances to the deities while keeping the deities to your left. Right? But for devotees, it's not applicable. We can pay obeisances, you know.
But we can pay even to the left. I pay Prabhupada, when I pay obeisances to Prabhupada, he is always on the left.
Yeah.
So, I'll give an example of a few. For example, one of the limbs of bhakti is in describing Hari Bhakti Vilas also, and you know other places, is to decorate one's body with the names of Bhagavan. But is that allowed with the names of the devotees of Bhagavan, or is it allowed only exclusively with the names of Bhagavan? So please tell me, Kirtida Sundari Mataji.
Tricky question. I don't know. Why not, Prabhu? Because I've seen devotees, you know, decorating their body with the name of Tulsi or Tulsi plant.
Right.
Especially those who do their tattoo.
Right.
So they can do it also.
So let's say this is a, you are saying that this is a slightly tricky one. Let's take another example. He said to reside in the abode of the Lord, like Mathura and Vrindavan.
That makes sense. Yeah.
So to reside in the abode where the Lord has appeared is one of the 64 limbs of bhakti, Mathuravas. But to reside in the abode where the devotee has appeared has not been listed anywhere in Shastra as a limb of bhakti.
So,
therefore, Rupa Goswami also knows that there are some limbs which can become a little tricky when executed in relation to the bhaktas. Therefore, Srila Rupa Goswami has very clearly used the term prayah. Prayah means almost all of them are applicable to the seva of the bhaktas. So, whenever in practice, we will understand which limbs are applicable to the devotees and which limbs may not be applicable to the devotees. So, this is, you know, therefore, Srila Rupa Goswami has said that almost all limbs of bhakti can be applied to the service of the bhaktas also. Now, moving ahead, you know, why is it so that Sri Vrindavan Das Thakur is saying that, you know, glorifying devotees is more important and it is more potent than glorifying the Lord? Because it is very clearly specified and experienced in our lives that actually, it is the devotee who is the cause of bhakti in our lives. Unless a devotee arises in our life, it is impossible for anybody to become a devotee. Very rarely it may happen that, you know, it did not happen suddenly that one day, you know, we were all non-devotees before, and one day suddenly Bhagwan came in our dreams and said, Hari Parshad Das, wake up. Your name is actually Hari Parshad Das. Wake up and start executing my bhakti. Go to the ISKCON temple, start chanting your 16 rounds, start following four regulations and become my devotee. So this did not happen. What happened instead is that bhakti came in my life through the agency of a devotee. So devotees are agents of distributing bhakti in the lives of other living entities. So between Bhagwan and the Bhakta, it is Bhakta who voluntarily comes in the life of a devotee. So why is it that Bhagwan doesn't come? I would like to ask a question once again. So today, I would ask, like to ask, you know, certain questions. Why is it that, you know, Bhagwan doesn't come directly? And why is it that the devotee comes directly in order to distribute bhakti? Bhagwan could also have come to distribute bhakti directly to all the living entities. But Bhagwan doesn't come directly to distribute bhakti to all the living entities. The devotees come to distribute bhakti to all the living entities. And why is it so? If this question is asked, then the answer to that question is because the devotees, they distribute bhakti yadrichhaya. Yadrichhaya means, you know, according to their own sweet will, with no other cause in their mind. Now, let's say if Bhagwan also does that, Bhagwan also starts distributing bhakti according to his own mind. You know, he desires that certain person X should get bhakti and certain person Y should not get bhakti. Bhagwan could have also done that. So why does Bhagwan not do that directly? So I would like some answer. Would anybody like to give an answer to this question? Why Bhagwan doesn't, you know, like to distribute bhakti directly?
Because then he could be accused of being partial.
Yes, beautiful. Thank you so much. Then Bhagwan will be accused of being partial. And he has himself, you know, said so many times that I am equal to everyone. I am in everyone's heart. Sarvasya chaham hridi sannivishto. And he has also said, na me dveshyasti na priyah. In Bhagavad Gita, and I'm not inimical to anyone, nor is anyone excessively dear to me. So I am equal to everyone. But if he starts partially distributing bhakti to certain living entities, and if he doesn't distribute bhakti to other living entities, then the sadhus will immediately raise their fingers and say, dear Bhagavan, sorry, but you are exhibiting a nature contradictory to your own statements in Shastra. Therefore, please, for the time being and forever, give up this distribution of bhakti by yourself. Give it in our hands. Sadhu say, we will distribute bhakti. Because we cannot be accused of being biased in our nature. Yadrichhaya, we felt that somebody should get bhakti, we gave it to him. We felt somebody should not get bhakti, we did not give it to him. So nobody will accuse us of bias. So Srimad Bhagavatam also specifies very clearly that when somebody is about to get liberated from this world, the first thing that happens is he gets the association of devotees. And only after getting the association of devotees, then he gets love of Krishna. And after getting love of Krishna, then you know, his life is successful. So in Srimad Bhagavatam, these are Muchukunda's prayers. And in 10th canto, chapter 51, verse number 53, he says, Bhavalpavargo brahmato yada bhave janasya taryachyuta satsamagamah satsangamo yarhi tadaiva sadgatau paravareshe tvai jayate matihi. It says, bhava apavargo brahmato yada bhavet. Bhava apavargo, you know, the extinction of material existence. Brahmato, for a living entity who is wandering, yada bhavet, when it occurs. So when a living entity who is wandering, when the extinction of his material life approaches near, then janasya tarhi, at that time, achyuta, O Lord, what does he get? Sat samagamaha. He gets the samagamaha, the complete association of sat, of sadhus. Sat sangamo yarhi tadaiva tad sadgatau. And when he gets that, tadaiva, only then sadgatau, he becomes, you know, inclined towards sadgati. The sadgati is the true path, which is the Lord. Paravareshe. No, he is the Lord of all universes. Tvai jayate matihi. In you know, O dear Lord, his mind, his consciousness, his love becomes fixed. So his mind and his consciousness become fixed in you only after he attains sat samagama, attains the association of sadhus. So the cause of becoming a devotee is sat samagama, association of devotees. This is the translation. When the material life of a wandering soul has ceased, O Achyuta, he may attain the association of your devotees. And when he associates with them, there awakens in him devotion unto you, who are the goal of the devotees and the Lord of all causes and their effects. So, in this way, it is very clear that first and foremost, there will be association of devotees. And only through association of devotees, there will be attainment of bhakti towards Bhagavan. So, dear devotees, this is a very important point, and this clearly establishes the reason for worshipping devotees to a greater extent than worshipping Bhagavan himself. Because Bhagavan did not come in anybody's life directly and said that from tomorrow start executing my bhakti. The only person with which that happened was maybe Arjun in Bhagavad Gita, where Bhagavan came in his life and said, become manmana bhav mad bhakto mad yaji mam namaskuru. Bhagavan directly said, become my devotee. And after Arjuna, everybody else has been hearing the same statement of Bhagavan through the agency of the devotees. So maybe Arjuna, because Arjuna was already an eternal associate of the Lord. But for those of us who are conditioned in this world, who are not eternal associates of the Lord, so it is important that we first get the association of devotees. Therefore, you know, in Srimad Bhagavatam, again, there is a statement by Vidur. And Vidur makes a statement because he is very happy in association of Maitreya Muni. So Vidur says in Srimad Bhagavatam, 3rd canto, 7th chapter, verse 19, Yat sevaya bhagavatah kutasthasya madhudvushah pratiraso bhavet tivrah padayor vyasanardhanah. So, yat sevaya bhagavatah, by serving whose lotus feet, yat sevaya, by serving the lotus feet of the devotees, the guru, bhagavatah kutasthasya madhudvishah, all these are, you know, adjectives, kutasthasya, madhudvishah are adjectives of Bhagavata. You know, towards Bhagavan, who is kutastha, who is ever unchanging, who is madhudvishah, who is the enemy of the demon Madhu, you know, towards Bhagavan, something develops. What develops? Rati raso bhavet. You know, rati raso, ratir ullaso, or, you know, the joyous, you know, transcendental ecstatic emotions develop towards Bhagavan. Tivraha, you know, to a great degree. Padayor, in his lotus feet. Vyasanardhanaha. And this rati rasa, this ecstasy vanquishes, you know, all material distresses. Here is a translation. By serving the feet of the spiritual master, one is able to develop transcendental ecstasy in the service of the personality of Godhead, who is the unchangeable enemy of the Madhu demon. So when we say unchangeable enemy, so unchangeable is not the adjective of enemy. Who is unchangeable, comma, who is the enemy of Madhu demon, and whose service vanquishes one's material distresses. So this is how the verse should be understood. Otherwise, it will become unchangeable enemy, wherein Krishna is nobody's permanent enemy. So unchangeable is a separate adjective, and Madhu Dvisha, enemy of the Madhu demon, is a separate adjective. So the verse wants to say that by serving the devotees, one develops Rati Rasa. One develops the various varieties of Rati of transcendental attraction towards Bhagwan. And that transcendental attraction is very important for the progressing conditioned soul in the material world in order to reach Bhagwan. Without having rati, without having sthayi bhav towards Bhagwan, it is not possible to have bhakti rasa. And without having bhakti rasa in one's heart, it is not possible to attain the service of Bhagwan, eternal service of Bhagwan. So these verses are very clear in the message that they are trying to give. Now, moving ahead, you know, this is a verse from Srimad Bhagavatam. There are many other verses which Srila Rupa Goswami quotes in the Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu. Srila Rupa Goswami quotes another verse in the Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu glorifying the devotees. See, one of the limbs of 64 limbs of bhakti is to serve and glorify the Vaishnavas. So Srila Rupa Goswami says in Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, Shankha Chankrankita Tanuhu Shirasav Manjari Dharaha Gopi Chandana Liptango Drishtascheta Dagham Kutaha Shankha Chakra Ankita Tanuhu. You know, when if you see a Vaishnava whose tanu, whose body is marked with Shankha and Chakra, with conch and chakra, Shirasa, and on his head, Manjari Dharaha, you know, you can see he has, you know, he's holding Tulasi Manjari on his head. Who touches the Tulasi Manjari on his head? Gopi Chandana Liptango. And Gopi Chandana Lipta Anga, you know, whose body is decorated with Gopi Chandana. Drishtaschet, if you see such a devotee, Tad Agham Kutaha, then what is the question? Where is the question of sins remaining in your life? So, here is the translation. On seeing the body of a devotee decorated in his body with symbols of a conch and chakra, carrying tulsi manjaris on his head and with limbs painted with Gopi Chandana, where is the question of any sinful karma remaining? So, Srila Rupa Goswami also glorifies the devotees in this way in the Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu. Further, Srila Rupa Goswami also quotes another verse from Srimad Bhagavatam, 1st Canto, 19th chapter, verse number 33. So this is a verse by Parikshit Maharaj. He is saying to Shukadeva Goswami, Yeksham samsmaranat pumsam sadhyah shudhyanti vaigriha kempunar darshana sparsha pada shauchasanadibhi. Yeksham samsmaranat, simply by our remembering, and devotees like you, pumsam sadhyah shuddhyanti vaigriha, our houses become instantly sanctified. Kim puna, then what to speak of? Darshana, seeing you. Sparsha, touching you. Pada shaucha, washing your holy feet. Asana, offering you a seat in our home. Adibihi, etc. And executing other limbs of bhakti in relation to you. So dear devotees, there are many verses like these which directly prove that worship of a devotee is much superior to the worship of Bhagwan. Now, when we say much superior, some individuals say, then why worship Bhagwan? Why worship Bhagwan? Because ultimately, at the end of one's journey of bhakti, one has to be situated in a sthayi bhav, in a rasa pertaining to Bhagwan. So one's sthayi bhav has to be in relationship with Bhagwan. Therefore, ultimately, the relationship of the jiva is with Bhagavan. Nityo nityanam, chetanas chetananam, eko bahunam. So, he is the one who is having a relationship with all the living entities. Ultimately, they are connected to him. So, our ultimate relationship is with Krishna. And that is an eternal relationship. But we also have eternal relationships with various other jivas, especially those who are our Gurujanas. With them also, we have an eternal relationship. And that relationship is to be valued immensely. And that relationship is to be valued even more than the relationship with Bhagwan. Because although we have relationship with Bhagwan for exchanging rasa, but still that relationship became possible only by the mercy of the Vaishnavas and Sri Guru. Therefore, in the beginning of his Mukta Charitam, Sri Raghunath Das Goswami, you know, he is quoting a verse where he says, you know, he counts many, many gifts that he got from his guru. Nama Shrishtham Manumapi Shachi Putra Matra Swarupam Rupam Tasya Grajamurupuri Mathurim Goshtavatim Radha Kundam Girivaramaho Radhika Madhavasham Praptam Yasya Pratitakrpaya Shri Gurum Tam Natosmi. Nama Shrishtham, I got the topmost holy name. Manumapi, and I got some secret Gayatri mantras also. Shachi Putram, I got Shachi Putra, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu in my life. Atra Swarupam, and I got Swarup Damodar Goswami. Rupam, I got Rupa Goswami. Tasya Grajam, and his elder brother Sanatan Goswami. Urupurim Mathurim, I got the best of cities to reside, Mathura Mandal. Goshtavatim, in Mathura Mandal also, I got Vrindavan, the area of Vrajamandal. In Vrajamandal also, Radha Kundam Girivaram Aho. I got the specific area of Giriraj Govardhan and Radha Kundam. Aho Radhika Madhava Asham. And I got an Asha Bandha, a hope of service to Radhika and Madhav. Prapto Yasya. I got all of this by whose Prathita Kripaya, by whose extensive mercy. Shri Gurum Tam Natosmi. Unto that Sri Guru, I offer my humble obeisances. So, before worshipping Bhagavan, always worship Guru, always worship Vaishnavas to a much greater degree than worshipping Bhagavan. Krishna also says in the Srimad Bhagavatam, Aham Bhakta Paradhina, that actually I am subservient to the devotees. It's very important to gain favor of a devotee who is a Mahabhagwat in order to attain seva of Bhagavan. Now, for this reason, dear devotees, we should understand that so many verses of glorification have been composed for the devotees. So many verses are also for the Lord, but there are many verses of glorification also for the devotees. So I would like to share one or two verses from the Padyavali. Padyavali is a very nice literature. I'd like to share one or two verses from the Padyavali, you know, which are glorifying the devotees. And these verses are very nice because these verses are glorifying the devotees in a poetic manner, in a very poetic manner. I would like to share my screen. The first verse is by a devotee poet named Shri Autkala. Autkala means a person who resides or who is born in Utkala Desh. Utkala means today it is known as Odisha. So Shri Autkala in Padyavali says the following. Tebhyo namostu bhavavaridhi jirna panka संलग्न मोक्षण विचक्षण पादुकेभ्य कृष्णेति वर्ण युगल श्रवणेन येषाम् आनंद थुर्भवति नर्तित रोम वृंदः. He says, तेभ्यो नमोस्तु, obeisances to all those great devotees. You know, who are those devotees? So, adjectives of those devotees are being described. So glorification of devotees, obeisances to devotees. Who are those devotees? So adjectives are being described one by one. So the first adjective is, this entire term is an adjective. Bhava varidhi jirna pankasam lagna mokshana vichakshana padukebhya. This is an adjective. So in English, you usually have to go in the reverse direction. Padukebhya, whose footwear. Those devotees whose footwear are vichakshana, you know, they are, you know, expert in mokshana, in liberating. Liberating whom? Liberating those conditioned souls who are fully stuck, samlagna. Stuck in what? In the panka, in the mud. Which mud? That mud which has become jirna, you know, old and rotten. Which old and rotten mud of Bhavavaridhi, of the ocean of material existence. So those devotees whose footwear, whose slippers, or whose shoes are, you know, expert in liberating those conditioned souls who are stuck in the rotten mud or rotten dirt of material existence. Okay. And describe more. And those devotees, yesham, you know, for whom Krishneti Varna Yugala Shravanena, when they hear Shravanena, Krishna iti Varna Yugala, the two syllables Krishna, what happens? Their Nartita Roma Vrindaha, their hair stand on end and appear to dance. They experience goosebumps. And Ananda Thurbhavati, these goosebumps experience a lot of joy. You know. So this is the translation. Obeisances to those devotees whose footwear is the most expert instrument of deliverance of those conditioned living entities who are stuck in the old rotten mud of the ocean of material existence, and whose bodily goosebumps appear to dance and experience great joy upon hearing of the two syllables Krishna. So this is a very nice verse of glorification. Another verse is composed by Sri Sarvananda. It's compiled in the Padyavali by Srila Rupa Goswami. This verse is in the meter Shikharini. Sri Sarvananda says, Hari smrityaladasti mitamana soya asya kritina Sarumanchah kayo nayanam api sananda salilam Tameva chandrarkam vah purusha dhaure yamavane Kimanyaistair bhairair yamasadana gatya gati parai. So Sri Sarvananda is speaking to Avani, the earth. So he is saying in the third line, he is saying, Avane, O earth, please do something. You know, what should I do if the earth asks? He said, Vaha, carry the load. Carry the load of whom? Purusha Dhaurayam, of that greatest amongst human beings. You know, you should only bear on your surface those greatest amongst human beings. Achandrarkam, till the sun and moon exists. Don't let them die. You know, keep holding them on your surface. So which great people are you speaking about? And speaking of the devotees, which devotees? So those devotees, yes, yeah, whose Hari Smrityahladas Timitamanaso. You know, whose mind, manasa, is stimita, becomes agitated by the ahlada, by the joy experienced due to smriti, remembrance of Hari. Whose mind becomes agitated by remembering Hari. Hari smriti ahlada stimita manasa. Yasya kritina, or that, you know, virtuous devotee. And that devotee, saroman chah kayah. And that devotee whose body is decorated with romanch, with erect goosebumps. And that devotee, Nayanamapi, whose eyes also are Sa Ananda Salilam, are decorated with tears of joy. If you find such a devotee, Tam, that devotee, Eva, only that devotee, Achandrarkam Vaha, carry that devotee, bear his load upon you, O earth, till the sun and the moon exist in the sky. Because they are Purusha Dhaurayam, because they are the topmost amongst humans. And so, you know, what about other people who are not devotees? Then Sri Sarvananda says, Kimanya istair bhare. What is the use of carrying the load of those other non-devotees? Because they are Yama Sadhana Gati Agati Parai. They are devoted only to one thing. And their only task is Gati Agati, going and coming back. From Yama Sadhana, from Yamaraja's abode. they have booked a permanent return ticket of Yamaraj's abode. So they go there, they stay for some time, they experience their hellish punishments and they come back. And then they again go there, they stay for some time, they experience their hellish punishments and they come back. So what is the use of carrying those, you know, people whose only business in life is to make round trips, you know, return flights to Yamaraj's abode? So, O Earth, don't carry such people. So this is a glorification of the devotees. So this is the translation. O Earth, as long as the moon and sun continue to exist, you should carry the weight of only those virtuous devotees, those topmost humans whose minds are agitated due to the excessive joy caused by remembrance of Hari, whose bodies are filled with ecstatic goosebumps and whose eyes are filled with joyous tears. What is the use of carrying the useless load of others, non-devotees, whose only business is to travel to and fro from the abode of Yamaraj? So, dear devotees, in this way, you know, there is a lot of glorification of devotees. The verse today was about glorification of devotees, and I tried to begin with glorification of devotees. I tried to speak about the same glorification of devotees. And what is the glories of glorifying the devotees? What are the glories of the glorification of the devotees? So we tried to cover all these points today. And all of this, dear devotees, is included in Krishna Anushilanam, in bhakti. This is directly bhakti, and it improves our chances of gaining the mercy of the Lord immensely. So with that, I again would like to pray to Sri Vrindavan Das Thakur with the verse with which we began. And this verse, you know, is in glorification and prayer to him. Shri Vrindavan Das Sakhya Chaitanya Charitanugaha Srimad Vrindavanesmabhyam Vidadhatu Ratim Sada. The devotee named Sri Vrindavan Das Thakur is a devoted follower of the character of Sri Chaitanya. May he always bestow deep attraction towards Sri Vrindavan for all of us. With this, I would like to thank all the devotees who are present here, especially the devotees who organize Bhakti Sangha Japa Conference, Vinita Gandharvika Mataji, Priti Vilasini Mataji, Kirtida Sundari Mataji, all the other Matajis and Prabhus who organize the conference. Thank you very, very much for kindly inviting me and honoring me. Yadatra skhalitam kinchit vidvam saha purayantu tat. Yadatra saushtavam kinchit tad guru reva menahi. Yadatra skhalitam kinchit. If there was anything mistaken in the presentation, then vidvam saha. You know, you all are learned devotees. Purayantu tat. Please fill the gaps. Correct my errors. Yadatra saushtavam kinchit. Whatever was nice in the presentation, if you felt anything was nice, tad guru reva. It belongs to my gurujanas. May nahi, it doesn't belong to me. So thank you very much, dear devotees. Jagadguru Srila Prabhupada ki jai, Ananta Koti Vaishnava Vrinti ki jai. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji, Dandavat Pranam. All glories to you, all glories to Srila Prabhupada. What a wonderful, wonderful session, Prabhu. And just one request, Prabhu, if you allow, that the verse that you have written in glorification of Srila Vrindavan Das Thakur, with right. your permission, can we recite every day before we start our Chaitanya Bhagavat?
Sure. It's an open source verse. So you can.
No, we can circulate and we can just tell everybody that if they want to recite, you know, in glorification of Vrindavan Das Thakur, then they can. So I want definitely. To just seek your permission.
Definitely.
Thank you, Prabhu. Thank you for this wonderful, wonderful session. Really appreciate. Hare Krishna. Your classes are always, you know, they bind us to one place, and with focused attention, we don't want to miss even a single sentence. Especially for myself, I'll talk about myself. That it's really, you know, it hooks me to one place. It glue me to one place. So, thank you so much, Prabhu. Hare Krishna.
Thank you, Mataji. Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna Parshad Prabhuji, please accept my humble obeisances. Thank you so much for such a beautiful, beautiful class, an enlightening class today. You enlightened us on the 64 limbs of bhakti. And I really liked when you said from Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 10, Chapter 51, Verse 53, that we all, it's so important for us to have devotees association if one wants to be liberated or even if one wants bhakti. Thank you so much for your great and wonderful association today. Dear devotees, if you have any questions or realizations, please go ahead.
Mataji, there are raised hands, so you can take one by one.
Sure, Mataji.
Yeah, Gaurangi Mataji, please go ahead.
Hare Krishna Prabhu.
Hare Krishna.
Two questions. One is, you know, the devotees, if they are the ones who pick and choose to whom to give this bhakti, they cannot be accused of being partial. So why is that?
Because they are not sarvagya, omniscient like Bhagavan. They are jiva tattvas. So on the only person, for in order for someone to be completely impartial towards everyone, he has to understand the heart of everyone. But that is not possible for a jiva tattva. It is only possible for Bhagavat tattva, for Vishnu tattva. And since the devotees are in the category of jiva tattva, therefore they cannot be accused of being biased because they are not omniscient. Only a person who is omniscient and then he selectively chooses certain jivas, that person can be understood to be biased, not someone else. So I hope that clarifies.
Yeah, I do have to digest that a little. But just initially, I would say that if a person were understanding everybody, right, where everybody's history, where they're coming from, everybody's heart, right, then such a person would not pick and choose.
Obviously, yes, because, you know, they would technically fall in the same category as Bhagavan, and then Bhagavan doesn't pick and choose.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Let's say, you know, God doesn't play dice with the devotees' lives. You know, that's what.
Yeah, I mean, to say a corollary of that would be, I would say that, you know, if, oh, I don't think I can sort out my thoughts so quickly here. But okay, let me just go to the other question, which is when you were discussing the Padya believers, you were talking about the footwear.
Hmm.
Is footwear synonymous with service to the devotees?
Yeah, because footwear is compared to service of the devotees because, you know, the feet are the lowest part of the body, and service to the feet often, you know, is considered to be an act of great humility. So if somebody serves another person's feet, it means they are completely surrendering to that person. So the footwear or the feet, they are denoting service in complete humility and surrender. So that is the meaning of, that is the indicated meaning.
Okay. Thank you, Guru.
Thank you. Thanks.
Arunanda Mataji, please go ahead.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji, Dandavat Pranam Prabhu, thank you. Prabhu, I have two questions. First one is, when you're mentioning devotees in the whole context, what sort of devotee do we understand, Prabhu? Because often they say pure devotee, and it is so hard to understand who is a pure devotee. Then you have to sit and meditate upon their, you know, their bhakti, their sadhana, instead of ours, whether they're a pure devotee or not. So can we take it as in devotees in general?
Should we glorify and respect only the pure devotees, or should we first find out who is a pure devotee and what should we do? That's the question, right?
Yes, Prabhuji.
So Srila Rupa Goswami has made everything very easy for us, because in the Upadeshamrita, Nectar of Instruction, he has composed a verse specifically for specifying how different devotees who are on different levels of advancement should be respected. So in verse number 5 of Upadeshamrita, Sri Rupa Goswami says, Krishneti yasya giritam manasadriyeta tikshasti chet pranatibhishcha bhajantamisham shushrushaya bhajana vigram vijya mananya manya nindadi shunya hridamipsita sangalabdhya. So different, there will be devotees of different degrees. We will be able to see devotees in different degrees of advancement. In Nectar of Instruction, verse 5, he is specifying how to, you know, respect and glorify devotees on different levels of advancement. Yeah. Is the translation by Srila Prabhupada. Level 1, one should mentally honor the devotee who chants the holy name of Lord Krishna. So if one is simply chanting, not initiated new devotee, mentally honor them. Then level 2, one should offer humble obeisances to the devotee who has undergone spiritual initiation and is engaged in worshipping the deity. This is level 2. Level 3, one should associate with and faithfully serve the pure devotee who is advanced in undeviated devotional service and whose heart is completely devoid of the propensity to criticize others. So there are these three levels of service and glorification have been specified by our acharyas. So we already have the yardstick given to us and we can accordingly offer respect. So I hope this verse clarifies the answer to what you had to ask, the question you had to ask.
Yes, Prabhuji, thank you. I'll look into it more deeply. And the second thing, I was just wondering, when Vidura comes back, Yudhishthir Maharaj was saying that, you know, such people, because they carry Krishna Hari in their heart, so they themselves are the pilgrimage. So, and then when you were mentioning to Kirtika Sundari Mataji that the staying in the abode of Hari is something that we cannot do to devotees, related to devotees, and that's why you explained almost thing. So yes. How do we understand? Yeah.
Wherever the devotees go, that becomes a tirtha, that becomes an abode. But whose abode? That becomes an abode of the Lord. That doesn't become an abode of the devotee. Ultimately, tirthas are related to the Lord. Tirthas are places where the Lord appears. So wherever the Lord appears, that place becomes a tirtha. And therefore, to reside in such tirthas where the Lord has appeared, that is one of the limbs of bhakti. But that doesn't necessarily apply to the place where the devotee has appeared, because devotees may appear in various places in around the world. But it is not described anywhere in Shastra that one should spend one's entire life residing in that place. So when it comes to permanent residence, one has to select the abode of the Lord, where the Lord has appeared. And these are some examples of limbs which are like, you know, which can be executed only in relation to Bhagavan and not necessarily in relation to bhaktas. So that those are some examples which I was giving. But there may be, you know, there may be other examples too. You know, I only gave one example. There may be other examples too, which, you know, we can try to find. And these examples may be, you know, applicable only to the Lord, but not to the devotees. So that is all. That is what I was trying to explain. Nothing else.
Thank you so much, Prabhuji. Dandavat Pranam. Hare Krishna. Very helpful.
Thank you. Hare Krishna.
Omkar Prabhu, please go ahead.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji, Dandavat Pranam.
Dandavat Pranam.
Prabhuji, I had two questions. First question is, when we say about association with devotees, advanced devotees and pure devotees, so how should we understand it? Like, how much time are we associating with them? Or practically how to serve them? Because sometimes we may disturb their bhajan due to, you know, our trying to associate with them. So how to know this, the point, how to associate well with the devotees, especially new devotees who have been initiated very less time.
Yeah, so there is a how to associate with devotees, especially those who are advanced. in order to associate with devotees who are advanced, we should understand that the devotee who is advanced should take some specific interest in us. They should become snigdha. They should become favorable and loving towards us. But that is often not a very easy thing to do, because for them to become favorable towards us, we should also reciprocate with them. Often what new devotees do is they are always in, you know, receive mode. I want to receive as much inspiration from him as possible. I want to receive as much as I can receive from this pure devotee. And then they do not often consider, what are you giving back to them? When new devotees are asked this question, what are you giving to them? Then they say, he doesn't deserve anything. He's not asking for anything. He's a pure devotee. He has no desires. So he doesn't ask for anything. He just gives. This incorrect assumption is made by many new devotees. Sri Rupa Goswami has said very clearly in Upadeshamrit, fourth verse, Dadati prati grihnati guhyam akhyati prichyati bhungte bhojayate chaiva shadvidham priti lakshanam. If you want to have priti with any devotees, there has to be dadati prati grihnati, that there has to be give and take of some, you know, gifts. And it doesn't make a selfish relationship. In every relationship, even in the spiritual world, there is dadati prati grihnati. There is give and take of some emotions, some gifts, something which the other person likes. So if we ever come across a pure devotee, then we should try to give some service, give some gift, give something which is close to the heart of the devotee. It can be a service, it can be a gift, it can be anything. But then that is how the devotee knows that you are exhibiting some priti. And then the pure devotee also reciprocates with priti. And when he reciprocates with priti, then that is the wide open door for the advancement of the new devotee. So that every devotee should understand. Because what happens is, when somebody becomes labeled as a pure devotee, then when you go to Vrindavan or when you go to a dham, you know, the people tell this particular Prabhu, this particular sannyasi, this particular Babaji, he's a very advanced devotee. So people immediately line up to hear from him, you know, to receive. And then after a few days or months, because they don't get any personal interaction with them, so then they feel disappointed. Oh, why is he not, you know, giving special attention to me? That's because there is no priti. Why is the priti not there? Because there's no dadati prati grihnati guhyam akhyati. Dadati prati grihnati first. Then when he gives some specific attention, then guhyam akhyati prichyati. Then when there is more affection, bhungte bhojayate. This is shadvidham priti lak. Priti has to be established between that personality and us. And that is when, you know, it will be clear, very clear that we have attracted the attention, the affection, the mercy of the pure devotee of the Lord. So I hope this helps, you know, in shedding light on your query.
Yes, Prabhuji. So we can't force anyone's priti.
No.
We can't force our devotee.
No. How can it be forced? It's not a mechanical formula. We think that because we did something, though he must be, you know, compelled to reciprocate. But they're not compelled to reciprocate. Neither are we compelled to reciprocate, nor are they compelled to reciprocate. But we should, on our part, we should continue to do that. And after some time, they will definitely reciprocate with us. So, you know, this is something which, you know, I personally experienced in my life with my Guru Maharaj, that he asked me to do something. And when I did it for him, he was very happy. He reciprocated with great affection. So that, you know, something which was close to his heart. So that, you know, we should do, we should try to do with someone who is a Diksha Guru or Shiksha Guru, who is our Bhajan Guru. And then we can 100%, the door is wide open. Hare Krishna.
Yes, Prabhu. There's a second question. Prabhuji, we hear many Vaishnavas, they point out that we should see the Lord in every person and every being.
Right.
Also, yes. But sometimes it seems as if It's as if you're mixing something. Like, we may obviously see Lord in other devatas or other person, but sometimes it seems that we are getting confused between that deity and the Supreme Lord. We tend that they both are equal. There is also this tendency sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
How to understand this?
Well, you know, when we see, how do we see Bhagavan in all living entities? Is that the basic question?
Yes, Prabhuji. Because sometimes they say that, you know, we have to see all the deities equal. So it goes to that extreme sometimes.
No, you can take the example of Bharat Maharaj. Because Bharat Maharaj, there is an example in Srimad Bhagavatam 5.7.6. There is the example of Bharat Maharaj. I will show you the screen. You can yourself read the translation. So it's Activities of King Bharat, Chapter 7, Paragraph 6. So okay. Yeah. Please read the translation.
After performing the preliminaries of various activities, Maharaj Bharat offered the results in the name of religion to the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Vasudeva. In other words, he performed all the yajnas for the satisfaction of Lord Vasudeva, Krishna. Maharaj Bharat thought that since the demigods were different parts of the Vasudeva's body, he controls those who are explained in the Vedic mantras. By thinking in this way, Maharaj Bharat was freed from all the material contamination, such as attachment, lust, and greed. When the priests were about to offer the sacrificial ingredients into the fire, Maharaj Bharat expertly understood how the offerings made to the different demigods was simply an offering to the different limbs of the Lord. For instance, Indra is the arm of the Supreme Lord, Personality of Godhead, and Surya is his eye. Thus, Maharaj Bharat considered that the oblations offered to the different demigods were actually offered unto the different limbs of Lord Vasudeva.
Yes. So are all living entities not also limbs of Lord Vasudeva?
Yes.
So therefore, Lord Vasudeva is present in them. Are you not present in your arm?
Yes.
But is your arm you?
No.
No. Similarly, Lord Vasudev, all living entities are limbs of the gigantic universal cosmos personality, Lord Vasudev. In this way, he is present in everyone. But everyone is not equal to him. They are all living entities are subsets of the universal set, which is Bhagavan. But does that mean that the subset becomes equal to the universal set?
No.
You read set theory, na? In mathematics?
Yes.
So that's what it is.
Yes. Thank you.
Thank you. Hare Krishna.
Hindu Lekha Karuna Mataji, please go ahead.
Hare Krishna Prabhupada, Dandavat Pranam, all glories to Srila Prabhupada. Thank you for the very wonderful class, Prabhupada. I just had one clarification. So you are explaining about how devotees can be considered, like a person gets the association of devotees and it's only through them that they are getting to the Lord. So, but we also say that the guru is the expansion of the Paramatma in the heart. Right, or manifestation of the Paramatma.
Is the representative of the Paramatma in the heart.
Yes, Prabhuji. So, my concern is like, yes, right now we are in the section where we have to glorify the devotees. And so in this stage, the devotees are definitely way more glorious than the Lord. But then always from the Shastras itself, they will say that, okay, yes, how the God is also, Lord is also very, very glorious. So doesn't everything start with the Paramatma first? for, I mean, for us to even receive the mercy of devotees, doesn't the Paramatma have to actually bless us?
Well, if the Paramatma starts selectively blessing people, will Paramatma remain partial or impartial?
The Paramatma is always seeing everything that we are doing. So based on the activities, I guess, he's kind of impartial.
So if he, well, if he, based on the activities of the jivas, if he gives them bhakti, then bhakti will become subservient to the activities of the jiva, won't she?
Yes, Prabhuji, that is correct.
But bhakti is not subservient to the karma of the jiva. She arrives independently. That is the conclusion. She may appear in the life of a person who is most impious, and she may not appear in the life of a person who is most pious. That conclusion is given in Madhurya Kadambini by Sri Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur.
Prabhuji, I think the question is related to that when we say that bhakt ke bina bhagwan nahi milte hain, but bhagwan bhi na chahe to bhakti bhi nahi milti hai. Like we say that we get the mercy of a spiritual master if Krishna is pleased, then we get an association of a spiritual master. And through spiritual master, we get to know Krishna.
Right. So, but then who comes first in the entire equation for the conditioned soul?
No, definitely but, devotee is coming first.
Obviously. Oh,
go ahead, Mataji.
No, that's true. Devotees come first, but it is said that, you know, if you, that somebody asks that, you know, how will I get our spiritual master? Then we always tell them, right? Chant sincerely, pray to Krishna, and your spiritual master will be revealed to you.
No? That's after they have entered into the process of bhakti. That's about guru. But what about meeting the devotee who introduces us to bhakti, the first guru? How does that devotee come? Is there a formula?
Some by chance.
Sukriti, Sukriti Prabhuji. Some then past.
Then bhakti,
like in the Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu itself, we learn about how it's a cycle, but then the mercy of a devotee comes in somehow, accidentally.
Right, right. That's, yeah. So then the only term for that is Yadrichhaya. Yadrichhaya means without any cause. By its own cause. Bhakti comes by her own cause, and if bhakti comes by Sukriti, then bhakti will become dependent on Sukriti. If bhakti comes by Dushkriti, impious deeds, then bhakti will become dependent on Dushkriti. So bhakti is neither Sukriti Janit nor Dushkriti Janit. She is not produced by Sukriti or Dushkriti. Bhakti comes out of her own sweet will. And when I speak of arrival of a devotee in one's life, I am speaking about the point at which a conditioned soul again turns his face towards Bhagavan. That very moment is generated by whose mercy? Please think about it.
That is by the devotee's mercy. Only that, by Guru's mercy can we get Bhagavan.
Yeah, that is by the devotee who introduces us. When Bilwa Mangal Thakur begins his Krishna Karanamrit, which is the first name that is mentioned in Krishna Karanamrit, what is the first term? Anybody knows what is the first term of Krishna Karanamritam?
Jayati Somagiri.
Chintamani Jayati.
Chintamani, yes.
Chintamani Jayati Somagiri Gururme. It's very important to understand that the exact point at which the devotee turns his face towards the Lord is put into action by an existing devotee of the Lord. I'll give one last example. In the Brihad Bhagavatamritam, when Gopakumar returns back to Krishna, does anybody remember what Krishna says to Gopakumar?
I was waiting for you. Why take so long to come back.
Yes. Fate had me dancing like a fool, thinking that one day you will turn your face towards me. But there was nothing that I could do, you know, in order to turn your face towards. Why does Krishna express helplessness? Krishna says, I could not break my own laws, the laws which I have created. And I could not make myself directly intervene in your life and turn your face towards me. Then finally, after giving up all hope, the only final hope was that I made an exception in your case and I arrived in your life as Guru, Jayant. So even in the life of Gopakumar, Krishna had to take the role of a guru in order to turn him towards himself.
So Prabhuji, as we follow through that pastime, we see that Srimati Radharani herself, she asks Gopakumar to go down and help the Brahmana, right?
Right.
So then that is Lord sending his representative again.
That's Shakti. That's not Bhagwan. That is Shakti.
Thank you, Prabhuji. I think I'm still confused, but yes. Thank you so much, Prabhuji.
So that is Bhagavat Shakti. That is the potency of Bhagwan. That's not directly Bhagwan ordering them. And let's say in some cases, Bhagwan orders that some people should be delivered. So you do this, you do this. But in most cases, the devotee voluntarily selects somebody as a recipient of bhakti and that person gets bhakti. That is how bhakti is distributed. It is distributed by the sweet will of the devotee. That is the, in Bhakti Sandarbha, this conclusion is firmly established by Srila Jiva Goswami.
Prabhuji, but isn't that bhakti through bhakta comes only when our sinful reactions are done?
No.
Because how will it happen? You know, there should be some criteria. Like suppose if we go for book distribution, we knock on the doors.
Right.
So it's in one sense, it's our choice that which door we are going to knock.
Right.
But isn't it timed that whose door will be knocked and who will reciprocate in what manner?
No, that is determined by the jiva who reciprocates. Let's say you knock on 10 doors and out of them 8 doors don't reciprocate in a favorable way. That is because the jivas did not reciprocate. That is because of their swabhava, because they are bahirmukh. So they did not respond favorably. But two jivas responded favorably and they came to Krishna bhakti. And for those two jivas, you are the entry point into bhakti, not Bhagavan.
But Vaisheshika Prabhu always says, right, because they reciprocated. Why they reciprocated? Because they were ripe fruits. So who made them ripe? Unripe fruits will never reciprocate, right?
Right. What made them ripe? And that therefore the verse of Muchukunda that I quoted, that, you know, when their time of liberation is coming near, that is when they become ripe. And what is the reason for the time of their liberation coming near? That is still within the domain of uncertainty that nobody has determined as of yet in Shastra.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Prabhuji. You have taught us that from the very first person who even shows us a glimpse of Krishna consciousness, we need to be grateful to so many devotees. Thank you, Prabhuji. One other thought was, Prabhuji, so normally every class you would have a verse by Sri Hari Suri. Prabhuji, do you have anything to quote today? Hare Krishna, thank you so much.
Well, okay. A verse by Sri Hari Suri. I was translating yesterday. I'm on chapter 6, which is Putana Lila. And I was translating yesterday. And, you know, when Putana comes in front of Krishna, you know, Krishna closes his eyes And he gives many, many reasons for Krishna closing his eyes. So, one of the reasons which he gives for Krishna closing his eyes is mentioned in Sri Hari Suri's Bhakti Rasayanam. It's a very sweet verse. And I would like to show the original because, you know, it's in Devanagari. I have, you know, I'm sorry for those who only read Roman. So it's in Devanagari, but I would like to show this verse, which is by him. And then I would like to translate it for all of us. Yes, I'm sharing my screen. This is a verse by Sri Hari Suri, Bhakti Rasayanam. This verse, Chara Charatma, verse 27. Sri Hari Suri says, Krishna closed his eyes because of another reason. He says, Chara Charatma Yadayam Tatuntar Drisha Brisham Pashyatu Durmanaskam Bahir Drishanarha Nirikshaneti Kritam Tathatan Niminakshi Yugmam. So, Sri Hari Suri says, Characharatma Yadayam Tatuntar Drisha. He is Characharatma. He is the Paramatma sitting within all living and all moving and non-moving entities. Tato Antar Drisha Brisham Pashyatu. If he wants to look at Putana, let him look from his Antar Drishti, from his inner vision. Within her heart, let him see her. Durmanaskam, she is evil at heart. Bahir drisha narha nirikshana iti. But she is not worthy of external gaze. Kritam tathatan niminakshi yugmam. Therefore, Maharaj Nimi closed the eyes of Krishna. So Mataji, do you know who is Maharaj Nimi? Anybody knows? Who is Maharaj Nimi?
Is he the father of the Nova Yogendras?
He has a discussion with Nova Yogendras.
Nova Yogendras arrives at the fire sacrifice and Nimi, Maharaj Nimi was performed.
Yes.
And he instructs.
So Nimi Maharaj was a king who was the son of Ikshvaku. Ikshvaku is, he's the great king of the Surya Vamsh, of the Sun Dynasty. And once Nimi Maharaj received a curse from the sage Vashishta, and Nimi Maharaj at that point of time, you know, after receiving the curse, he was freed from the curse, but then he desired that I should never take a material body again. But he didn't want to take a material body again, so he was promoted as an associate of the Lord. But at the same time, he was also given a benediction that he will reside on the eyes of all the living entities. So, residing on all the eyes of the living entities, he performs one function, that is Unmesh and Nimesh. He closes the eyes and he opens the eyes. So, therefore Nimi is known as the, you know, king who blinks on people's eyes. So Nimi causes the blinking of eyes. And therefore Sri Hari Suri says that Nimi, who was sitting on the eyes of Krishna, was thinking that let him see from his inner eyes, because he is the Lord of all moving and non-moving entities. But I will not allow him to see this evil lady from his external eyes. And therefore, Maharaj Nimi closed the gates of both the eyes of Krishna, and so that he could not see her. So this is one very sweet reason that he gives. And then there is another reason. See here, verse 24, very nice. Drishta chet karuna drisheya managhasya chograya bhasmasat devam chedavashishyate yubayatha tadvasana samskriti. एतस्या हृदये तया च भविता जन्मान्तराप्तिः पुरा सामा भूदिति दुर्गदृष्टिरकरो दीश स्वदृङ्मीलनम्। Krishna was thinking, drishta chet karuna drisheyam anagha. If I see her with a merciful eye, Krishna was thinking, then she will become purified of all the sins in this life. Sya chograya, and if I see her with a cruel eye, bhasmasat, she will immediately get burnt up. Her body will be immediately turned to ashes. Evam ched, and if this happens, avashishyate yubhayatha, in both cases something will remain. What will remain? Tad vasana samskriti, her vasana, the seeds of her sinful desires will remain in her heart. And if that remains, etasya hridaye, if that remains in her heart, taya cha bhavita, then they will lead to something. What will they lead to? Janmaptarantihi puna, a rebirth for her again and again. So I want to destroy not only the sinful reactions of this life, but all the lives. Therefore, sama bhut, let me not look at her with a merciful eye. Let me not look at her with a cruel eye. The best way to do that is if I close my eyes altogether. And for this reason, Krishna closed his eyes when Putana came in front of him. So these are some reasons.
So nice, Prabhu. Wonderful.
Thank you so much, Prabhu. Yeah. Very nice way to see how Krishna has to think, right? He was saying that he's partial. So here, Krishna is thinking so much before he gives his mercy.
Yes. So that is, this is a different personality altogether. Hari Suri is beyond, you know, the standard line of commentary. He is in his different world of poetry. He was a different personality altogether. You know, his aim of writing a commentary is not to explain the meanings of the words. His aim of writing the commentary is to just create an ocean of bhakti ras so that everybody can dive. That is the purpose. That is the purpose of bhakti rasayana. Prayojan, that is the aim of the devotees' lives. Hare Krishna.
Prabhu, can you give a quick, how should I say, description of who this personality Hari Suri Prabhu is, please?
Yeah, I have spoken many times in the past. I'll still very briefly, I will introduce this personality. In the 19th century, this was around 1810 AD, around 1810 AD, in the village named Nashik. Nashik is in the state of Maharashtra, and it is about 100 kilometers from my native place. So in Nashik, in a family of Brahmanas, a personality was born. His name was Hari. So simply his name was Hari. So when he grew up, he learned all the traditional Vedic knowledge, branches of knowledge, grammar, Nyaya, Mimamsa, and he was a Rig Vedi Brahmin, a Brahmana whose branch of Veda is the Rig Veda. And but after learning the entire Veda, he was specially inclined to Srimad Bhagavatam, to Bhakti, to Krishna Lila, and especially to Kirtan. So he became initiated in the tradition of Sri Tukaram Maharaj, in the Kirtan tradition of Sri Tukaram Maharaj. And that is that branch in which he got initiated is named Naradiya Kirtan Sampradaya. The Sampradaya of Kirtan in the footsteps of Narad Muni. Naradiya Kirtan Sampradaya. And in this Naradiya Kirtan Sampradaya, every night they, you know, entire night they sing the leelas from Srimad Bhagavatam, and in the temple, one person stands and sings the entire leela. And so many people gather around him and listen to him. So this he was a member of the Naradiya Kirtan Sampradaya, and since he was so expert in his in all the arts and branches of Vedic knowledge, so with full determination he started serving Bhagwan in this way. At the age of around 30, he took a very severe vow in his life. His severe vow was that every morning he will wake up before sunrise, he will take a bath, chant his Gayatri, do his morning duties, and after chanting his Gayatri, he will chant 1000 names of the Lord, Vishnu Sahasranam. Then after doing that, he will recite 12 chapters of Srimad Bhagavatam. Every day, 12 chapters of Srimad Bhagavatam. Then after 12 chapters of Srimad Bhagavatam, he will do Gau Seva, service to the cows, for almost 1.5 hours. And only after that, he will eat the first morsel of food in the day. So this was his bhajan, his everyday sadhana. And he planned to continue that sadhana for throughout his life. But after carrying out such sadhana for 12 years, something happened. After 12 years, one day when he was doing the final part of his sadhana, he was in the cow shed doing service to the cows. At that point of time, somebody touched him on his shoulder. So by the very touch, he understood who it was. And when he looked back, he had his one darshan of Shri Krishna in his life. He mentions this in his book. And then Krishna told him that since you are so learned, I want to give you a special task in your life. He said, what is that? He said, in the 10th canto, I have carried out many pastimes, but there are many hidden reasons behind those pastimes. I will give you the seeds of all those reasons within your heart, and then you fluff them out, elaborate upon them by using your poetic power. And my dear boy, Krishna addressed him like this, my dear boy, I accept you as my eternal associate, but do only one thing. And the last word which Krishna spoke to him was Likha, write this commentary. So Sri Hari Suri followed the order of Bhagwan Shri Krishna, and he wrote Bhakti Rasayanam, a composition of 4,500 verses on the 10th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, very detailed, intricate verses, multiple layers of meaning. You need knowledge of multiple branches of Vedic knowledge to understand this work. So very difficult work and very sweet work. Hare Krishna.
Yes, this Naradiya Kirtan Sampradaya, how does that figure in with the four Sampradayas?
Well, the thing is, it is coming from Sri Tukaram. And we know from Chaitanya Charitamrita that Sri Tukaram was initiated by Chaitanya Mahaprabhu.
So then why do we not say that there are actually five bona fide Vaishnav Sampradayas instead of four?
With sub-branches, there are hundreds of sub-branches. But the main branches are four. Ours is also not a main branch. Gaudiya Vaishnavas are a sub-branch of the four branches.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you, Prabhu.
Prabhu, do you have time, Prabhu? I know it's late for you.
Yeah, I have all the time, as long as...
And the question... Yeah. Yes, Prabhu, the question is also not very nice. So I will still ask. Prabhu, the thing is, like, when you said, when Gop Kumar came and Krishna said, and before that also you said, you know, it is what makes the jiva go back. And few classes back, you had said that we have never seen Krishna, we have never been with Krishna. I don't know if you remember, but I remember very well, because that was a very, very difficult thing to digest and first time hearing that we have never been to Krishna. And then when you said coming back, so how do we reconcile this, that coming back and we have never been with Krishna, or we have never seen Krishna, something like that. Did I make my question clear, Prabhu?
Right. See, the thing is, the jivas who are bahirmukha, who are in this material world, they were never in the eternal association of Krishna. That's a certain fact. So where were they originally? So it is determined that they were in the Brahma Jyoti originally. And from the Brahma Jyoti, Krishna also desires all of them to turn towards him. but they are not turning towards him. But Maya attracts them. They fall down in the material world from the Brahma Jyoti, because the Brahma Jyoti is a common layer of it's a layer which shares its boundaries with the material and the spiritual world. So Maya can snatch those jivas who are looking away from Bhagavan. Even in the Brahma Jyoti, those who are looking towards Bhagavan, those who are favorable towards Bhagavan, Maya cannot snatch them in the material world. Now, after they come in the material world, Krishna still desires that they should come back to him. Come back in the sense, you know, they should at least come to the Brahma Jyoti, and after coming to the Brahma Jyoti, they should also progress ahead and come to his abode. And that is how Krishna desires for all, each and every conditioned soul who is present within the material world. So that is the answer to your query, Mataji.
Beautiful. Thank you so much, Prabhu. Hare Krishna. Thank you so much, Prabhu. Wonderful.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji. Once again, I would like to thank for your great association and beautiful nectarian class today. If there's no more questions or realizations, with Prabhuji's and devotees' permission, I would like to end the call.
Yes, Shivani Mataji, you can go ahead.
Vancha kalpata rubhyascha kripa sindhu eva cha patita naam pavane bhyo vashni bhyo namo nama ananda vashruvind ki jai namacharya Haridas Thakur ji ki jai Shri Prabhupada ki jai Shri Chaitanya Bhagavad Adi Kanda class ki jai His grace Hari Prashad Prabhu ji ki jai Hari Krishna dharma pranam
Shri Prabhupada ki jai Hari
Krishna thank you so much Prabhuji
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, everyone. Thank you.